It's the heart and soul of American music, WHVW, Hyde Park.
And that, my friends, is the Tulsa sound that you'll recognize because it means it's Roll on the Radio. It's 5 o'clock, and you're here with us for Roll on the Radio with your guest, Carey Harrison, also known as the Bishop of Woodstock. And we are here with two wonderful guests today. We're here on behalf of our sponsor, RollMagazine.com, now exclusively online. That's Roll, R-O-L-L, magazine, one word, .com, which is your online source of up-to-date wit, wisdom, and information about local culture, upcoming shows, exhibitions, concerts, cuisine, gardening, books, money, and even your stars. So join us on online. You'll see some quite gorgeous pictures of upcoming art shows, and I'll talk about that a little later. You're listening to WHVW on 950 AM, and if you happen to be in the area of Monticello, Maine, you can hear us on 780 AM on WXME. I think I would be fair to call them our affiliate. And this is a new expansion of our topography right up to the Canadian border. Of course, if you go online, you can hear us even in Timbuktu, as Ahmed's communication about his struggles with his wife and his camel keep us informed. So you're listening to WHVW, the heart and soul of American music. And if you have been listening, you'll know how true that is. This really is the heart and soul, not only of American music here on 950 AM, but in many ways the heart and soul of America itself, in the music that our glorious leader, J.P. Ferraro, the owner of this station, has located for us, and through which the old America, at least speaking for my generation, beams, the great America of the 20th century, its great music, its great culture. So we're here, slightly surprisingly, this afternoon to talk not about American culture for once, but about European culture. And I have with me, I'm delighted to say, Mikhail Horowitz, who is our first guest to return to us. Certainly not, I like to think, for the last time. And I can see Mick on the verge of speaking. He is one of the world's great humorists, but also never encountered a conversation that he didn't want to be a part of.
Well, the fact that I'm returning is an illustration of the fact that what goes around runs aground.
I like that, particularly here. However, Mikhail, who came to us before in his guise as a peerless stand-up comedian and singer of quite wonderful songs of his own invention.
Avec Gilles Malkin.
And he was here, indeed, as he says, as I was about to say, with Gilles Malkin. Today he's here, I was going to say, in the serious guise of an intellectual, but we need not overstress the serious. Now, we also have with us Pola Chapelle, who is here in her guise, in fact, as the widow of Adolphus Mikas, who had a project on the subject to which our show is devoted. But it's wonderful to have her here, and it's a shame not to hear her singing. Her life as a chanteuse is something we really ought to be celebrating as much as we're celebrating Giordano Bruno. Some of you may know the great cosmologist and philosopher who was burnt alive in the Campo dei Fiori in Rome at the behest of the Inquisition and the Pope. He had flitted around Europe, and in Venice, of all places, he was betrayed and taken to Rome and tortured and delivered to a death for which the Vatican has recently expressed regret, as Mick was pointing out to me. The wording is the Vatican regrets, rather as you might turn down an invitation to supper. I suppose it's really beyond anybody's power to express truly what an institution might feel about having burned one of the great spirits of all time. It is beyond words. Now, the springboard for this occasion was a gathering in Rome to honor Giordano Bruno, and I'd like to get on to how that came about, what it was, and more about Bruno. I was hoping we might begin with a poem of Mick's on the subject of Bruno, and then we will introduce him more fully to you.
This is titled Campo di Fiori, which is the name of the piazza in which Giordano Bruno was murdered. On February 17th, in the year of their Lord, 1600, they frog-marched a man from the future into this plaza, and having cut his tongue, lest he infect the crowd with further heresies, they kindled the wood and watched his body blacken into ash. But the sparks from the pyre of Giordano Bruno, part and parcel to the same fireball that ushered the universe into itself, ascended to heavens infinite in number, stars whirling without end, without limit, and somewhere another Bruno, a billion billion Brunos, laugh at the center of everything and join the stellar dance.
Mick, what a wonderful poem. And it touches on so many of the things.
Grazie.
Niente, signore. And so many of the things that we will be discussing, the extraordinary contribution that Bruno made, the extraordinary modernity of his thought, which we might say even the fatal modernity of his thought. And as an introduction to Bruno, Pola is going to read to us from an outline that her husband Adolphus was organizing as part of the project that was to be a Bruno film.
Yes, well, it was the part that he would send out to people interested in the hopes of a return of a check or something of that sort. So you'll see that in the last paragraph. But I think it says it pretty clear. Am I not talking directly into the... I thought I was. He was a Dominican monk. Now we're speaking about Giordano Bruno, who, by the way, was called Filippo and not Giordano. But he took the name. A poet, a playwright, philosopher, astronomer, freethinker, and an intellectual rebel. He was burned at the stake February 17th, 1600, as a heretic. His heresy was that he believed the universe to be endless and that it contained many worlds.
Yes, but I can't push them up any further. And I've asked them to get as close as they can.
He believed... Shall I go on?
Yes, yes, Pola, dear, please.
He believed that the earth moved around the sun. He didn't believe in the virgin birth or the divinity of Jesus. He openly mocked church dogma, such as wine turning into blood. Escaping possible arrest by the Inquisition in Naples and Rome, he left Italy and lectured in universities all over Europe, published many books and broadsheets. Betrayed by his benefactor in Venice, he was arrested and for 8 years imprisoned and tried by the Inquisition in Rome. Frightened by the spread of Protestantism, Pope Clement VIII order Giordano Bruno burned at the stake as a warning to those who disobeyed the church and its teachings. His books were burned and his name was forgotten. Slowly, over 200 years, as more and more of his books were found, his reputation grew as a thinker, writer, and astronomer who was ahead of his time. In 1899, a giant statue of Giordano Bruno was erected in Campo dei Fiori, where he was martyred. When Pope Leo XIII objected to it, the students from the Art Institute in Rome turned the statue around so that his back faces the Vatican today. This film will be made in the usual Adolphus style. Expect the unexpected and accept the impossible. It will be a combination of Eisenstein's rhetoric, Dreyer's visual clarity, Romare's ethical purity, and Michael Moore's intrusion into the private life of Giordano Bruno, all done in Adolphus's lyrical, romantic, nonsensical vision of the world. And I just want to add that what got him excited about this project was exactly those words in the New York Times, where they said, the Vatican regrets. I mean...
Yes. Yes, that would be an inspiration. All right, we would start one off. And it's such a privilege, Pola, to have you here. And this movie fans, true movie fans everywhere will know the films of Adolphus and of Pola's brother-in-law, Jonas, and will know that through them we're in touch with a whole world of 20th century and 21st century cinema. And we can only speculate as to what Adolphus might have made of this material, but somebody, hopefully, it's time to make that movie in some form, if not in his own inimitable form. And most of this program, most of this show will be dedicated to talking about Giordano Bruno in various ways. But I should add, for anyone who's happens upon this program and thinks that they have got a particularly eccentric Christian wavelength on the radio, perhaps it might be worth pointing out that it's not only as a so-called heretic who was burned by the church, as many have been, that we're celebrating his life on this program. Everybody, every victim of the Inquisition should be celebrated. But Giordano Bruno was also a philosopher for the ages and was, as Pola said, progressively discovered and progressively embraced and still leads the way in many respects. It's only in recent years that cosmologists and subatomic particle physicists have decided, really in the last couple of years, almost as briefly as that, that it's not only that there are parallel universes, but that there is something that is now called the multiverse. Yeah. And this is something that embraces what Bruno himself saw long, long ago. So this is a man of exceptional vision and a man for today as much as for all time.
Yeah, yeah. This was a guy who came about 100 years after Copernicus. And he went much, much further than Copernicus went. He posited, well, here in his own words, innumerable suns exist. Innumerable earths revolve around these suns in a manner similar to the way the seven planets revolve around our sun. Living beings inhabit these worlds.
Yes, this was unspeakably shocking as a thought at the time. And even now, it's a challenge to what we were educated in this generation even to believe in terms of cosmology. We are still trying to catch up to Giordano Bruno, is the truth of it.
But just to backtrack a little bit, both Pola and I were in Rome and Naples recently. And I'd like Pola to tell your listeners a little bit about why we were there and what we were doing.
We definitely want to hear that. Well, I'm just going to interrupt.
Yes.
And this is where I want to, I'm hoping to go in the next segment, yeah, if I may, to keep our listeners up to date. You're listening to WHVW on 950 AM, unless you happen to be up in Monticello, Maine, in which case you're listening, bless you for listening, on 780 AM on WXME, or you are wisely tuned in to our program online. You can go there, whvw.com, and you will see that a link will take you to hear us in almost perfect sound. It's probably the best sound in which you can find us. But we're there available to the whole world, which is a wonderful thought. And we're here this afternoon with Mikhail Horowitz and Pola Chapelle, and we're discussing the great, the unforgotten. Unforgotten. I'm tortured by a word that was taught to me by CNN yesterday, where they described a non-unusual event.
Oh,
and I'm hoping to use this for the rest of my life.
Just don't misunderestimate Giordano Bruno.
He should not be misunderestimated. So our non-unusual event today is the joy of having two wonderful guests who are not only here to talk about the great Giordano Bruno with us, but actually attended a ceremony. Oh, God bless them. I'm so envious. In Rome.
Two ceremonies in Rome and one in Naples.
Oh, two in Rome and one in Naples. Pola, you were going to tell us about how this came about.
Well, Adolphus had actually left notes. One of them was, we have to go to Rome on February 17th and make a short film of what occurs. So I gave a call to Mick. I don't know why, really, at this time. He and Adolphus were very close. They sort of, a mutual admiration society was.
It was that we discerned that that anarchist sensibility really, really early on right. in both of us. We're both rascals and mischief makers and provocateurs.
So, and Mick said, sure. And then I
had to think about it for exactly 3 seconds when she said, an all expenses paid trip to Rome. I said, okay.
And then David Newhoff, who is actually a graduate of the Bard Film Department, has his own little production company in Rhinebeck. He was and a student of Adolphus's, an ex-student. And he was available and said, of course, and his wife Scarlett said, of course.
And I'd like to read something that David wrote on his blog a little later on, but he wrote a really brilliant essay, and it ties together a lot of different threads of what we're going to be talking about.
Well, we did go, and we stayed. The first thing that happened was we stayed in Brussels airport for 6 hours, and I don't advise anyone to have to. Oh, okay. So we moved on, got to Rome. Our friends were there, our wonderful friends, Daniela and Gigi. They have a little B&B. They opened it to us and the cats and everything. And we then found out we had to rush off to Naples, that the next day, that was a Friday night, I think, the 15th, the next day, a Saturday, there was a production, a play, having just been written, I think the man said in two or three months.
It was a pageant about the life and death of Bruno with great actors in costume. It was in the convent at San Domenico Maggiore, where he had been a friar as a young man.
Where he went when he was 15 years old, you know. Anyhow, we did that, and we met,
Well, I was going to say we got to interview I got to actually interview Giordano Bruno because I interviewed the actor in costume, in character, as Bruno, with Cardinal Bellarmine acting as the interlocutor. And that was really marvelous because he really knew what we were doing. He was really into it, and he was a good actor.
Well, it was the director whose name, by the way,
Fabio Quercia.
Quercia. It's, you know, oak tree.
Oak tree.
Yeah.
That's his name. And he wrote this in, you know, gathered all the information together, wrote a really powerful Giordano Bruno role. And this young man had absorbed it all. It was marvelous. It was really good.
Tremendous.
Then we got on the train and came back to Rome. And
the next day, it was February 17th, the date of Bruno's execution. And for the last, 20 years or so, there has been gatherings in the Campo de Fiori. There's a huge statue that Pola mentioned with its ass turned towards the Vatican, a huge hooded Bruno
Indeed.
Looking gravely down.
Famous dungeon.
He's looking gravely down at the stalls of vegetables and fruits that they sell in this marketplace. And I had this image when we were there. I was looking at the statue, looking at all these smashed vegetables and crates of fruits. And the lines of another visionary, William Blake, came into my head. And I realized that the least shred of strewn garbage, to quote Blake, opens into eternity of which this vegetable earth is but a shadow. And so we had this assemblage of free thinkers, anarchists, mystics, all laying wreaths at the foot of the statue of Bruno and making speeches, some of which were stupefying and interminable. But it was quite an event, and it culminated with going to the Teatro Sala Umberto.
No, but it culminated in the police band of
Rome. Oh, yes, the police band, which was a wonderful irony.
Actually, a great irony. And they played not only, they started off playing John Philip Sousa Walk
All
Marches,
right.
which is...
As a tribute to Bruno, but it was the The Guardia Civil? It was
it was the police band.
Yeah, it was the actual municipal police
band. Municipio.
Right. These are the same guys that would have hauled him to the pyre in 1600. And so that was something.
Yes. And then we went to the theater, and we had to go to the Sala Umberto, it's called.
Yeah.
I don't know if you know it. It's lovely. Lovely.
The place was packed.
Yeah.
And it was a program put together by a woman named Giuliana Conforto.
Yeah.
And she's an erstwhile astrophysicist who glommed onto Bruno's ideas when she was still a scientist. She has since discarded being a scientist. She is now a full-time visionary. But she put together a marvelous program. giving me a hairy
I
eyeball.
I love Giuliana.
I love her,
she's,
too, but
no,
you have to admit...
No, she's seen things that I'm afraid will happen.
Well, perhaps.
And
perhaps.
Really? Her father was an astrophysicist.
Yeah. Right.
And passed this all on to her, and she's perfectly understandable to me.
Did she confide any of her prophetic visions?
I'm afraid
she did, but we probably shouldn't go there.
Ooh.
Because we want you to think of her seriously. And
and not the way people thought of Giordano Bruno
exactly.
400 years ago.
Exactly. But,
shame,
so.
Shame,
but she's
shame.
Been a great champion of Bruno's, and she put together a marvelous program. There was music by Respighi, Busoni. On the program, there was clips from the only film previously made about Giordano Bruno, which for some reason featured lots and lots of female nudity, but it was a Carlo Ponti production.
It was backed by Carlo Ponti.
Yeah.
What else?
And so we had the filmmaker talking to us about it. And then Luigi Pavan, guitarist, and our friend, and I managed to weasel ourselves onto the program, and we played a Giordano Bruno blues for the assemblage. And I don't know if they got everything, but they were very enthusiastic in their reception of it. I can play it for you.
I see
now,
that the harmonica in your hand, and it would be very disappointing if we didn't hear the Giordano Bruno blues.
All right, the only caveat here is that to really hear this correctly, we need a guitar and a bass, but you're just going to have me and the harmonica. So if you can bear with that.
We will, with great delight.
Here's the Giordano Bruno blues. The universe is not finite. The universe extends to infinity. The universe is not finite. The universe extends to infinity. For challenging Aristotle, the church put me to death for heresy. Well, I rambled through the old world,
ramble to England, France, and Germany. Yes, I ramble through the old world to many a court and university. I was a free-range philosopher, a beatnik of the 16th century. Yes, and everywhere I rambled, my views reproved the dogma of the day. Yeah, everywhere I rambled, I contravened the dogma of the day. For daring to speak the truth, they locked me up and threw the key away. Oh, the flames that burned my body, the very flames that scorched me through and through. Ah, the flames that burned my body, the very flames that scorched me through and through. They're only a shadow of the fires of liberty that I bequeath to you.
The Giordano Bruno Blues.
That was the Giordano Bruno Blues by Mikhail Horowitz, interpreted by Mikhail with some assistance from Pola Chapelle there.
But, you know, we should sing. Singing. What he did was turn Bella Ciao into...
Well, I also took the old partisan song, Bella Ciao, and at the very end, as a coda, we started getting everybody clapping.
Yeah, they were,
Giordano Bruno.
Illuminato.
Giordano Bruno. Illuminato. Bruno ciao, Bruno ciao, Bruno ciao, 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 Giordano Bruno, illuminato, and he still shines bright today. And everybody really got into that.
Oh, I bet they did.
And, you know, the finishing touch on this program, the grand finale, was an anarchist orchestra conducted by a marvelous woman named Giovanni Marini, who is kind of like, the Italian Pete Seeger. And just this impassioned woman in her 90s, just giving you the provenance of each of these songs, and then leading this choir and this raucous orchestra, and just belting them out. It was great. It was a kick-ass finale to the show.
Right, right. And may I say what? Then I'm sitting down in the first row because I couldn't find a seat. Now can you hear me? Yes. And. Giuliana motioned to me to come up on the stage, and all this band is going on and playing these songs, and the people are applauding, and I get up there fine, and I'm bowing, and then she hands me the mic. I don't know what I'm going to say. The band is playing, the people are applauding, and I go, "Power to the people!" And they went crazy. It was great.
I would think that was the
great.
Perfect response.
I mean, free thinkers of the world unite.
We're here this afternoon with Mikhail Horowitz and Pola Chapelle talking about Giordano Bruno, the philosopher and cosmologist who was burnt alive on the orders of the Pope of the Vatican, and for whom several celebratory events were organized recently in Italy. They brought Mikhail to them to sing the Giordano Bruno Blues, and Pola, too, whose late husband had a plan to make what would certainly have been a wonderful film about Bruno, and to celebrate the continuing revival of Giordano Bruno. We're here on behalf of our sponsor, RollMagazine.com, that's R-O-L-L magazine, one word, .com, now exclusively online, and bringing you many wonderful articles about what you should be seeing and attending in the Mid-Hudson Valley. In particular, this week the editorial staff has brought us a magnificent roundup of the art that's available this month and next. And the images are so beautiful, as they infallibly are on RollMagazine.com, that even if You don't have a particular or personal interest in going to galleries in our area. I think when you see these paintings, you might change your mind. And what this article covers are a number of solo artist exhibitions not to be missed, including Carl Van Brunt's Digital Confections in Beacon and Mary Reed Kelly's witty working objects and videos at SUNY's Samuel Dorsky Museum in New Paltz, a place that we often celebrate here online. It's a great jewel, a great privilege to have it near us, and always worth a visit with its many fine exhibitions. The Tivoli Artists Gallery in Tivoli, 60 Broadway, also has an intriguing show happening from March 7th through Sunday, March 30th. It's still on, entitled Awakening, a mixture of artwork and essay, and participating artists include Karen Caton, Susan Fowler-Gallagher, Gilbert Rios, Roxy Johnson, and Carl Falk. And their gallery there, the Tivoli Artists Gallery, is open Fridays 5 to 9, Saturdays 1 till 9, and Sundays 1 to 5. And crossing the river to Kingston, because the staff have written this, beginning on the other side of the river, now on our side, the Poughkeepsie side, the Kingston Museum of Contemporary Art plays host to a group of MFA students from SUNY New Paltz in a show with, as the article puts it, the eloquent title of Ardent Rift. Well, the Uptown Gallery, 296 Wall Street, near the corner of John Street, features work by artist Roberta Sickler. The Uptown Gallery is also the headquarters for the Kingston Festival of the Arts, and the owner, opera singer Carey Henderson, and resident curator Gloria Waslin host monthly culinary salons that are becoming a feature of Kingston and beyond social life. Back across the river in Woodstock, two major group shows for your delectation. The Woodstock Artists Association Museum Wham's March show, juried by Wayne Lemke, and the Birdcliff Guild's annual member show. The show at Wham has an emphasis on abstract pieces, and there are some beautiful things there, noteworthy, as the staff points out, the Royal Magazine staff article is Michael Esposito's Untitled. And at Wham, there's also a small works group show in the Founders Gallery, definitely worth a visit. The Woodstock Birdcliff Guild's members show I recommend very strongly at the Clanet James Art Centre. It's entitled Ruckus, suggesting that the curators, Portia Munson and Catherine Umstead, were expecting the kind of headlong clashing of styles and genres one expects from a member's show. However, well, it doesn't entirely feel like a ruckus. There's tremendous dynamism, as the article says, in the show, thanks to the thoughtful design of the curators who've really put together what I feel may be the most impressive single show that I've seen while I've been in Woodstock. So there are many wonderful things to be seen. The Woodstock Framing Gallery features a view of Woodstock with new work by Anne Crowley, Christine Gamet, Maria Katzman and Rob Wade. In Saugerties, the Imogen Holloway Gallery at 81 Partition Street have their winter group show From the Vault, which continues through Sunday. So you can catch it if you hurry. Just I'm sorry to say that's actually is I'm too late with that, because I think if you missed it, if you didn't see it, you have missed the work of 17 artists, although I'm sure there's even more artists to be found elsewhere in these wonderful shows. So to look at something that's just begun, running from March 20th through April 27th, they have an exhibition of new works by Pierre Wright and Mandolin Wilson Rosen. The common concern of these artists is one of space, cramped, crowded, and compressed space. The artist reception, mark your calendar with this, is on Friday, April the 4th, from 6 to 9. And the winter hours are weekend hours, Saturday and Sunday, 12 to 5, and any time by appointment. In Rosendale, the Roos Arts at 449 Main Street brings together a father and a daughter. You don't necessarily find this all that often, in a show aptly entitled Relative Objects, paintings by Dan Green, sculptural works by his daughter Galen.
That's a great show, by the way.
Oh, thank you. An endorsement here for that show from Mikhail. The first time these artists have shown together, and it presents an opportunity to juxtapose their work while examining the interstices of influence and aesthetic. Dan Green, famous in the world of comic book illustration, long tenure as an inker and penciler for Marvel and DC Comics. This show shows another side of him, series of paintings inspired by his daughter Galen's childhood toys, and his most recent work incorporate photographic imagery from his childhood. And Miss Green, his daughter, is currently working on large-scale crocheted pieces, including life-sized characters from the classic Todd Browning movie, Freaks. That sounds extremely intriguing. Gallery hours are Thursday through Saturday, 1:30 to 5:30, and of course by appointment. And our next stop is Beacon and the Theo Gans studio in Main Street, 149 Main Street, and Carl Van Brunt's solo show Walking the Changes. And Carl Van Brunt has abandoned acrylics for pixels 30 years ago, and he now has an impressive record of digital artwork that has been shown extensively throughout the Hudson Valley. And his chief influences are jazz and Buddhism, and both are evident in his work, with the energy, the rhythm in the images, and the attention to symbol, pattern, and sumptuous color. This show runs through April the 6th. And there's Dear Beacon always in Beacon. And do try and get there to catch the fabulous installation of Andy Warhol's Shadows, 1978-79, before it ends on March the 30th. You still have a week, and very much worth getting to that. And at Vassa, at the Francis Lehman Loeb Art Center, the Malian photographer Malik Sidibe's exhibition that we've talked about on this show before. It continues through March the 30th. You can find details of that online on Roll Magazine. So you can see how very comprehensive this roundup is. There's more about what's on at the Dorsky Museum, and it makes us very fortunate to have the riches of in terms of artists that we have in the Mid-Hudson Valley. And you get a glimpse of them in wonderful, beautiful images on rollmagazine.com online. So we should return to the 16th century, and I see Mikhail studying a piece that he's perhaps going to bring us now.
Well, this is we had a great cameraman, the indefatigable David Newhoff, and he wrote a piece for his blog based on our trip. But he brings up another question here. You know, when the Inquisition burned Bruno or any other heretic, it's the old story of who controls the story, who controls the information that people will receive, and what is the official story, and who owns that. And this essay, I'm just going to read an excerpt from it, but this really considers that. He says, "History teaches us time and again that even the most creative forms of sadism can never fully terrorize the free expression of ideas into hiding for long. In both mythology and reality, we find a recurring theme of knowledge cracking the forces of repression like weeds growing through concrete. From Prometheus and Eden to the Inquisitions and contemporary brutalities in places like Iran, North Korea, and Russia, the battle rages over who controls the flow of information. After all, whatever Giordano Bruno was, scientist, artist, philosopher, or mystic, he is certainly in the pantheon of important pains in the ass of those who attempt to wield power by presuming to control the story." And then he goes on to make a really interesting correlation, I think, between technology and theology and theocracy. "The battle over who will control information certainly continues in the digital age, albeit mostly without bloodshed. Any sense that this control is now solidly in the hands of the people thanks to technology is, I believe, illusory. In fact, it isn't that big a stretch to compare a technocracy to theocracy,
since both produce a minority of powerful individuals whose amok egos allow them to presume the role of intercessor between the people and some form of salvation. We should therefore be wary of New Age cardinals who hail from the Great Valley, Silicon Valley, he means, and preach hip, progressive-sounding mantras. Given the tendency for the digital revolution to further consolidate wealth and devalue individual labor, I suspect that behind the pretty new words lurk some very old ideas.
It's wonderful to hear. For some reason, listening to that, an image came to me of Allen Ginsberg burnt at the stake, as in the wrong century,
with the wrong
people, he undoubtedly would have been. Pola, I wanted to ask you, because I'm sure everyone's intrigued to hear of Adolphus's prospective movie. What of that now? Is there a future for it?
Yes, yes, indeed. I'm waiting right now to hear from a young man who also attended Bard, but his second film was featured at Cannes. He's an Indian man, and by the name of Oshim Aluvalia. Oddly enough, Aluvalia means, he told me, potato seller. And potato was probably the vegetable that Adolphus loved the most. You know, once we had a New Year's Eve party, and he did all the cooking, and everything was potato. Everything. Okay, on to Oshim. So I'm waiting. I met Oshim in the summer, this past summer, and we kind of scouted locations, kind of because obviously there are places like, Giordano Bruno visited, and I don't know how long, the Queen of England. So we would have to, that's in the script. I'm sorry, that's in the script. Also, the King of Paris, the King of France, and that was in Paris. Anyhow, those things have to be costumed and magnificent, but we're trying, of course, to bring it in, again, in Mecca's fashion, very cheaply, because it isn't so much that's important, but more Giordano Bruno and how finally one sees him and the people around see him. We found an extraordinary, we also were looking for cast, extraordinary man by the name of Salvatore Poschi, I think, outside of the city of Bomarzo. He showed me where Pasolini had filmed the baptism in the Gospel of St. Matthew.
Yes.
It's an Etruscan, this is a whole area of Etruscan ruins, but some of them are not so ruins. I mean, you know, and the man himself was extraordinary. So right away I cast him as the man who would take the ashes of Giordano Bruno at the end of the film and take them to the Tiber. And what he would say, I think we'll leave it up to Salvatore.
Wonderful.
He's a but you know, a man who said, he has uncovered an Etruscan pyramid. You didn't know they made pyramids, probably. The Architectural Society of Italy, which is bothered by every kind of discovery, they knew about this. But he himself, with his own tools, uncovered most of it. Now he's looking for help. But I said, Oshim said to him, "But why do you do this? Why do you want to do this?" He's a farmer, and he has a farm, you know. He said, "Signora, because the young people today don't know anything about their past. They have really no roots. They go to school, they get, and they're off someplace else. And I think that perhaps they would be better off, they would live a happier life, if they knew about their roots and where they came from.
Certainly true.
He said it in Italian to die for.
Yes.
It was just so beautiful. So, yes, I mean, we'll be doing this, and we'll be doing it for as little money as possible. I don't know where from now, but we'll do it.
The script was finished?
The script is, yeah. It's more, you know, the way Adolphus wrote was, it was about 80 pages. And then depending on who we get to do this part and how we how he wants to extend the role of, say, the Venetian who betrays him, if we can find a good man to do that, somebody is beeping their horn.
Well, let them beep.
Anyhow, you know, if we find a wonderful actor to play the Venetian traitor,
We have a wonderful actor playing the adult Giordano Bruno.
Oh, Giordano Bruno we have.
Yes. Oh, how wonderful. Who is that?
His name is Giuseppe Zevola.
He looks like Pavarotti. He's got a barrel chest, and what he's been doing for years, he's been incarnating Bruno in performance, doing Bruno's poetry in Italian.
Wow. Marvelous.
You can find him on YouTube. You can see him...
He knows all his poetry by heart, and he'll recite, you know, he's an actor, he goes to Lithuania, he goes to Austria with, do you know Hermann Nietzsche?
I don't.
No, he does.
Younger brother of Friedrich?
Of who?
Friedrich?
Fritz. No, I don't think so. Not related to Fritz.
Anyhow, he performs
with
Friedrich's
Jewish brother, Hermann. Yeah.
He wasn't in Rome on February 17th when we were. I had no idea he would not be in Rome because he was in New York recording some Giordano Bruno with
Jonas.
With some Lithuanian musicians. So, we're sort of getting there and we're not, and I'm hopeful that this little film that we made, which is, I do have shots of Zevolo reciting, that we'll put together this and send it out.
The footage from the demonstrations where I was interviewing people off camera.
Oh, great. Yeah. Oh, that's marvelous.
And David was David just got some great stuff. And,
Well, mounting a film of your kind, Pola, the one that your husband and brother-in-law did, is always a seat of the pants operation, because that's the nature of independent movie making.
Yeah.
But this has a kick in the seat of the pants. It has considerable impulsion, the specialness of this project, as what he left behind. Mm-hmm. And then these celebrations on top of it, that makes it very hopeful.
I think so.
The time has come.
Well, I had more than ever since going to Rome with Mick and David, I had no idea that, for instance, we could fill a theater it's Rome, but to fill a theater, balconies, the whole thing with people
400 people, there wasn't 18, one
20
seat
euro
available.
To hear
to your program
about
on Bruno.
Giordano Bruno. Yeah. I mean, it's grown. And the time is right. I mean, my God, the time is right.
It certainly is.
Because he would still be a dangerous man today.
It's true. Sure. It's true. And it's still alarming to people to think about multiple universes and infinite numbers of universes. It's much easier to think that we are the only one. And that seems very doubtful, I'm glad to say.
Well, it was also his, besides the cosmological stuff, he was unafraid at a time when it was punishable by death to speak against church dogma. We'll just translate that to government dogma.
Exactly.
Or internet dogma or whatever it is. But, you know, there was his trial. They brought up 8 specific points against him, some of them terribly arcane, some of them, as simple as the fact that he denounced the idea of a Holy Trinity, he denounced the idea of a virgin birth. And at the same time, he was so smart and so sincere in his belief that he would argue with the tribunals. You know, his trial went on 8 years, and he was not
putting himself against the church. He was insisting that this is congruent with church doctrine.
Yes, they kept on having to bring him back because he insisted that he was a good son of the church.
But you know, right in front of me are the eight accusations made by Bellarmino, Cardinal Bellarmino, and none of them talk about the virgin birth and the Trinity, really. It wasn't that bothered the church, because there were a lot of people who didn't believe in the virgin birth.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, and the Trinity, okay.
Moi aussi.
Well, but no, none of them. I have them, you know.
Read them.
If I may,
read them,
the statement
there,
of. Yes. This is written by Bellarmino, translated from his perfect Tuscan Italian. The statement of two real and eternal principles of existence. The soul of the world and the original matter from which beings are derived.
That's number one.
That's one. Two, the doctrine of the infinite universe and infinite worlds in conflict with the idea of creation. Why? He who denies the infinite effect, this is what Bruno said, he who denies the infinite effect denies the infinite power.
Right.
Oh.
Three,
the idea that every reality resides in the internal and infinite soul of the world, including the body.
Quote,
there is no reality that is not accompanied by a spirit and an intelligence. Four.
Even Poughkeepsie.
Four, the argument according to which, quote, there is no transformation in the substance. Unquote, since the substance is eternal and generates nothing but transforms. Five, the idea of terrestrial movement, which according to Bruno, did not oppose the Holy Scriptures, which were popularized for the faithful and did not apply to scientists. Six, the designation of stars as, quote, messengers and interpreters of the ways of God. My God, what is wrong with that? You know, think about it today.
It's so beautiful, yes.
Seven, the allocation of, quote, both sensory and intellectual, quote, unquote, soul to earth.
That's right in with, what is it, Lovelock? Lovelock or Havelock? The Gaia principle.
Yes, it is.
The earth being a living organism.
Very much so.
Yeah, so.
And the last was the opposition to the doctrine of St. Thomas on the soul, the spiritual reality held captive in the body and not considered as the form of the human body. You know,
it's esoteric stuff, and you know, that could be debated, as could angels dancing on the head of a pin. You know, the third one interests me particularly, where you were citing poor Poughkeepsie as an example of the reality of almost anything that we could conceive. And there, of course, what's so threatening about that is he's really saying anything we can imagine is real.
Oh, sure.
And that's a gigantic thing to say.
Oh, yeah. How can you control... Yeah, you know, the imagination. When we start to do that, we go back. They were doing that in the 17th century. I mean, 7th.
Yeah.
Wasn't it the
16th remember? Century?
The 7th century, the Middle Ages, the Dark Ages.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
The Dark Ages, when at least I went to the movies and I saw Hugo's, you know, what is that with Sean Connery? That when he's a monk,
the name of the rose.
Oh, the name of the rose. Umberto Eco.
And so that borders on that kind of control over people.
Yes, it does.
Now, Carey, I just wanted to ask you one thing before we wind this up. You have written a novel in which Giordano Bruno is an essential part. What brought you to Giordano Bruno?
I think all the great thinkers who, since his time, have respected him and regarded him so highly. James Joyce, I suppose, was the first person to bring me towards that. And then I was writing about a period, that extraordinary period in which Shakespeare and John Dee, a miraculous period in European history, coincided and could all have met. And in my novel, an event happens which did not, so far as we know, occur, which was the encounter of the great magus and mathematician John Dee, Elizabeth's private tutor, with Giordano Bruno while he was in London. It's delicious to put these people together and imagine a conversation, so I really couldn't resist that. I've never been able to resist plucking great historical figures out and shoving them together and forcing them to have breakfast with each other in a way that they did never necessarily wanted to do. So we've been having a wonderful hour here. I can't thank you enough. It's been just thrilling for me, and I'm sure for the... grazie, signore, signora.
Prego.
Grazie, tutti e due. And
uno per tutti, tutti per uno.
Oh, tutto bene.
Certainly. And avanti, forza.
Nel mezzo del cammino di nostra vita, mi ritroverei per una selva oscura. Etc.
So,
thank you very much.
Thank you, Carey. Pola, so much. We've been really fortunate to have Pola Chapelle here talking about the project, the Giordano Bruno movie project, and Mikhail Horowitz singing Giordano Bruno to us and bringing Giordano Bruno to us in many forms, including a beautiful harmonica riffs. I didn't miss having a guitar at all. I thought it was just lovely.
Grazie, grazie mille.
It was really a great pleasure to have these wonderful people here with us. So please tune in again next week and tune in whenever you can to the greatest radio station in the nation. And I say that with real passion in my heart. This radio station is a gem. It brings you wonderful music, it brings you wonderful people, and it stands for a standard and a quality in American culture that you can't easily find on radio and on wavelengths that are dominated by cheap music and even cheaper talk. So come back to us here on WHVW whenever you can, and we will be thrilled to have you. Thank you, as a British broadcaster always says, thank you for listening, if you have been.
Bravo, bravo.